my name is Dr. Padilla. I'm a professor in computer science and psychology. I've been a professor for over 5 years. Now, during that time, I have seen dozens, maybe hundreds of PhD applications. So in this video, I'm going to give you my top PhD application mistakes that could cost you admission. So let's jump in. So the first mistake is all about the first impression. There might be a lot of different ways that you make a first impression. This could be emailing the advisor. This could be connecting with them at a conference, really whatever type of way that you're meeting with them initially. And you might botch that initial first impression. So what are the ways that you can botch those first impressions? One is sending an email that is unprofessional, that doesn't make the advisor want to respond or engage with you. So what we tend to see is that if you have not met an advisor before, you send an email asking if they are accepting new students and kind of doing an introduction. There's lots of things you can do to get that email wrong. Actually, I have a video on a similar topic that I'll link below. But the trick is that you wanna make a really great first impression. And if that first impression is bad, they're really not gonna look deeper into your application. It's very hard to overcome that. So think very deeply about how you construct that first email or whatever that first introduction is, and make sure that it's really effective. I think you also wanna be careful for first impressions when you're trying to connect with someone one-on-one or maybe after a conference or after a class. I think that people will really remember the first time they met you. So if you're coming to talk to them after they gave a talk or something like that, you want to have well-formed, articulated questions. You want to present yourself well, and I'm talking in every regard. So how you look, how you present yourself, how you communicate, all of those things will really matter, because when they're thinking about you as a person, they're not doing it in a quantified, objective way. They're thinking about you and they're thinking about their feelings. So if you came off kind of in an unprofessional way in some degree, they will remember that and it will essentially kibosh your application. They will not look more deeply at your particular application. The next major mistake I see are with the actual application documents. And a big one is with the personal statement or research statement. There's usually a document that you need to submit that is some articulation of your research or your personal interest in a particular program. Okay. And there are no rules about this. So you see lots of different varieties of how people put these together. I have a video on this topic as well with my recommended advice for putting those together. But what I wanted to talk about are the things that I see wrong. So the number one thing is I see that they can either be too short or too long. Again, there's no rules. It's not going to tell you on the actual website how long it should be. So what we see is anything under 2 pages is too short. I'm just going to tell you the unspoken rule. It's too short. So 1.5 pages, too short. If it's 2 pages and you have really big spacing between each of the lines, too short. Okay. This is your opportunity to communicate and advocate for yourself and really get people excited about your application. You need to have stuff to say. If you don't have things to say, it looks bad, like you're not prepared. Okay. So I'd really consider maximizing the space and try to go to the full page limit of whatever page it is. So if you're going to submit a 2-page document, fill up the full 2 pages. Don't have a lot of, you know, big quotes that take up multiple lines, don't have big line spaces. Fill up the 2 pages in a nice way. Same if you have 3 pages, same if you have 4 pages. Okay, so let's talk about if you're getting too many pages. 5, 6, 7 pages, too many. They're not going to read that. There's a certain type of person who is just a little overboard. And so you will come off as that type of person if you're submitting a 7-page personal statement or research statement document. You don't need all of that length. The sweet spot is anywhere between 3 to 5 pages. But really you want to say things that are interesting, make them well written, and don't add a lot of filler because people want to get through this quickly. I think some of the issue with these statements is you might be coming from an undergrad and you're given assignments, right? And they say, here's the page length, here's how you have to fill it. And I see students in class all the time kind of, you know, wanting to just meet the page limit. So they'll have, you know, the first part of the page be their name and date and the header, and they don't get to the writing until midway through the page, and then they end midway through the last page. So really it's a page short, right? Do not see this as an assignment. This is you getting the opportunity to convince someone that you are the best fit for the program, that you're going to be the most successful, that they want to hire you above all other people. This is your opportunity. Do not waste it with filler or fluff information that's not going to convince people. Another major mistake I see with these documents that might cost you admission is having no real structure. Now, you might have come from different disciplines and the structure is different across all disciplines. I totally get that. I think when you're submitting a particular statement like this, you need to pick a structure and go with it. So there's two ones I tend to see. One is linear, where you start at the beginning of your educational experience. You kind of build up through how each of those experiences led you to where you are now. And then you conclude with why you want to go into a PhD, why you want to work with a particular advisor, how all of this history of experience has led you to be the best applicant in this particular field. Okay, that's a linear approach. I think another slightly more successful approach is to have more of a problem statement, where you start with the type of work that you want to address, why that's important, and why that's a good fit for the lab or the advisor. And then you fill in all of the background experiences that have led you to be well equipped to conduct that research. And then with your background experience and what you're gonna learn in the program, you're going to conduct this amazing research and win Nobel Prizes, et cetera, right? I like that one a little bit better. I think they're a little bit more fun to read. But in any case, the trick is you need a structure. Oftentimes these statements, we don't know what's going on, right? It's kind of this kind of rambling list of things that are happening and we just don't know where it's going. So you need to pick a structure, make it clear that you're using a particular structure. Headings can be a great way to do that, organization the paper, but you need to communicate to the reader where we're going in this document, because they will get bored and kind of dismiss your application if it's not clearly structured so they can expect what is coming next in your research or personal statement. The last major issue I see for these personal research statements is failing to have some type of statement that connects everything you just described, your goals, with what the particular advisor is doing in the place that you're applying to. You might have really interesting work, interesting trajectory, but it's not clear at all how that's going to help this you, a particular applicant, execute the work with a particular professor. Every professor has their own research goals, has their own vision for their lab. So you have to connect what you've done with their work and show that there is synergy there, or there's a lot of overlap there, or you're going to advance the work in some capacity. I really see these statements fall flat when they don't connect everything you've done in the past with an advisor's specific work. How is this work going to be implemented with them? Why are you applying to work with them? What are your interests? So in these statements, just make sure to bring it home and connect all of those things together to have this kind of full body application material for your personal or research statement. The next major issue I see with PhD applications are in the letters of recommendation. And there's two types of issues I see. The first one is just overall lackluster letters of recommendation. And this can be very hard to remedy in the short period of time. What you need is strong letters of recommendation that are glowing. PhD spots are getting slimmer and slimmer, so everything is more competitive, and you need glowing letters of recommendation. A lackluster recommendation comes from someone who doesn't know you very well. They don't have personal experience with you. They don't have a lot to write. So this is usually from people that you've just taken classes with, you have cursory experience with. If you only have lackluster recommendations, that will kibosh your application. Now, along those same lines, only have letters of recommendation from the people that you've taken courses from is not great. So that would be three letters of recommendation from individuals you've just taken courses with. Those letters will look consistently the same. They will say, this student did really great in my class. They got an A. They might've done thus and such on a particular project, but that's all they can say about you, right? That doesn't give anyone indication if you will be a good fit for a particular lab, your research ability, how you work in teams, etc. So you need to have a letter of recommendation from someone who's directly worked with you on the type of research that you're applying to do for your PhD. If you do not have that, maybe consider waiting to apply for a year until you do have a really strong letter of recommendation from someone that you have directly worked with on a research or scholarly project. All right, moving right along to transcripts. This can also be tricky to reconcile, but what they will look for on your transcripts are if you have a low grade in a particular class that is relevant to your field. I don't know that it is completely imperative to have, you know, A's in every single course, but what will kibosh your application is if you have a low grade in a relevant course for your discipline. All professors will look through line by line through your transcript and make sure that you got A's in the courses that are relevant. So if you got a very low grade, a C or below, in a course that's relevant to the field, you're gonna wanna consider retaking that course. I'm going to be honest. To be competitive for these PhD programs, you have to ensure that you have strong marks in the relevant courses. So unfortunately, we do see that that type of thing makes it really challenging for someone to be admitted into a PhD program if they got a low grade in one of those courses that are relevant. And the last one for transcripts is actually not taking a course that would be relevant for a particular field. This happens to me all the time. I'm in the field of data visualization, and I'll have people apply from these wonderful universities where there's premier visualization scholars and researchers there, and they just didn't bother to take a class from one of those people. That actually looks pretty poorly on their transcript, that they didn't bother to take one of those courses, and now all of a sudden they're applying to a PhD in that particular field when they could have taken, you know, one of those courses before. So you have to think about that, for a particular subfield, most people know one another. So if you have the opportunity to take a class from a famous person in that field and you elected not to, that will actually look poorly on your transcripts. All right, so those are the major mistakes I see in PhD applications that could cost you admissions. These are really the ones that I see pop up over and over and over again that I also see my colleagues mentioning that really make them look negatively on a particular application. Many of them are easy to fix. They are about making sure you have good communication, you present yourself well, you know, you write your documents successfully. So those will be easier for you to fix, and you should definitely do so. The trickier ones are the ones that are a little bit more long-term. This is getting glowing letters of recommendation as well as the transcripts. If you have issues with those two elements, this might be an opportunity for you to evaluate if you're ready to apply for a PhD program. I'm saying this because we are in a new world where all PhD programs are going to be more competitive than they've ever been in history, potentially. So it might be worth your time to wait a year and try to get stronger letters of recommendation, maybe retake a course, maybe take a course in a particular field that you're applying for, and you'll have a much stronger application moving forward. I hope this was helpful. If you found this video useful, definitely consider hitting the like button and subscribe for more content on academic success. Academia can be tough, but you don't have to go through it alone. Keep learning, keep growing, and I'll catch you in the next one. Take care.